Good morning. I'd like to begin this morning by saying thank you. We completed our drive for Food for the Poor last week, and the total, I believe, is, correct me if I'm wrong, Nancy, was about $1,900, wasn't it?
Yes, that's about right.
So that's absolutely fantastic. That will go a long ways for them, and we really appreciate your generosity. We have a new opportunity for you beginning this morning. So our charity for April and May is the Ronald McDonald House. They've just opened a new location in Duluth. So you can see in your bulletin the things that they provide, and the church council will match up to $500 of those gifts. And if you'd like to designate it, write in your envelope or check Ronald McDonald House Charities, or RMHC. Also, April 24th, we will be once again heading down to a spring work day at Luther Park. We'll be there from 8:30 to 4:30. And this is a project that we have done annually now for many years, as it turns out. And I can tell you that the work that we do down there on that day for camp, in preparing them for the summer season, is an incredible gift that this congregation gives to the camp, and also it's an incredible gift for us because it gives us an opportunity to spend a day together working and building more and better relationships. So please feel free to join us for that. It really is always a fantastic day. Are there other announcements this morning? There will be no Bible study this week and next. I will be attending the Deputy Wing Chaplain course for the Air Force and not having to go to Alabama this time to do it, which is nice. So it's a remote course. I will be doing it either from the office here or at home. So I will be available, but in class from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. daily. So, any other announcements? All right. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Daddy.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and we cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, for the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God, and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. The gathering of him is life and his glory.
Thank you.
of love, you know our frailties and failures. Give us your grace to overcome them. Keep us from those things that harm us, and guide us in the way of salvation. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
A reading from Acts, the fourth chapter. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought all the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. And next reading is from John, the first chapter. We declare to you that what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the world of life, this was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father was revealed to us. We declare to you that we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with Father and the Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not know what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you, so you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is an atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours, but ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. So for the children's time today, what I'd like you to talk a little bit about, if you would, is the fact that it's still Easter. Now, I know that for a lot of holidays, we observe them and then they're done. But in the church, the celebration of Easter is not only a one-day event, but rather the season of Easter continues. And even after that, every single Sunday morning, as we gather here in the church for worship, it is a celebration of Easter. And why is that, you might ask? Well, it's pretty simple. It's because the celebration of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ is the reason that we gather. So, we celebrate Easter 52 times a year here at church. But for us, it's not just Sunday that's a celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. It's every single day. Because in Jesus' resurrection comes the greatest gift that God can give. And that's the gift of his love that grants us not only daily living, but also our own resurrection. So, what I'd like to talk a little bit about is how we celebrate Easter every day, how we make Easter a part of our daily lives. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It was a scary time. People were locked in their houses in fear, waiting for the other shoe to drop, waiting for that which was threatened to come to pass. Afraid to go out, nervous about the world around them. And that day was about 2,000 years ago. The disciples on that first Easter night were locked together in fear because they knew, having observed what happened on Good Friday, that now that Jesus was dead, that they were next. And that is exactly how you would expect it to be. Because the first thing that the powers that be would do is strike the leader. And next, come after his disciples. I cannot imagine the sense of dread anticipation that must have been present in that room, waiting for that initial knock upon the door, and then for that door to be pushed in. And Roman soldiers or the powers of the temple grabbing those 10 disciples who were there, because by this point, Judas was dead, and for whatever reason, it says Thomas was not among them, for those 10 to be grabbed, taken out, and meet a similar fate as Jesus. And yet, into that moment, into that sense of dread and that sense of hopelessness, comes Jesus. And what is the first thing that he said to those 10 gathered there? Peace be with you. For the disciples and for us, God does exactly the same thing. He walks into the chaos of our lives, and in the midst of that chaos, speaks those words. Peace be with you. Now, peace, I suppose, is a relative term. But the fact of the matter is, Paul says it, that the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. God's peace speaks to us in the midst of the chaos of the world swirling around us, and pronounces that even in the midst of the struggle, God's peace is something that transcends the problems of this world. Here's the other thing. Jesus didn't say this once. This particular evening, he said it twice. Because the next thing that Jesus says is, peace be with you. As the Father sends me, so I send you. Jesus doesn't remain contented with leaving the disciples in that place of fear. His commission that comes upon them, first and foremost, is to receive his peace. And secondarily, he sends them out. He sends them out into the world with the good news that Christ has risen from the dead. He doesn't leave them where they are. That's one of the most wonderful things, I think, about Jesus, is that he loves us enough to meet us wherever it is we happen to be, but doesn't leave us there. God loves us enough to break in the middle of the chaos of our lives and to change us through his word, through his love, through his sacrifice, and through his commission upon each of us for ministry. And we don't do it alone. Because what Jesus did then is gave the disciples an incredible gift. He breathed on them. And throughout the scriptures, breath or wind is an analogy that's used over and over and over again for the Holy Spirit. And said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. What does that mean? That means that Jesus not only sends them out into the world, but equips them for the ministry that's set before him. One of the things I dearly love about the Bible is that God never, ever calls people that are suited for the job. We can see it in the very early parts of the Old Testament and throughout the scripture. We can see it in every single one of the characters that we meet. They are not necessarily, no, they are not at all, the people that we might choose for the mission and ministry of the church. And yet, what God does is calls people who we may not think is equipped and gives them the power, the authority, and the tools for the work that he sets before them. He does the same with us. There is great hope in that, that God is in the business of not only commissioning people for ministry, you and I, but also equipping us for that work which he sets before us. And the freedom in that, of course, is that it's not all up to me, and it's not all up to you. rather that gift of the Holy Spirit that Jesus gives first to the disciples and then to all of us is the promise of his work through us. Here's something else I want you to notice. Jesus says, "Peace be with you," twice, as he's with the disciples that first night. Now, nothing is ever really complete in the scriptures until it's done three times. It's later. It's later that Jesus returns. Thomas wasn't there. And you know what? I cannot blame him at all for saying, "This is unbelievable. Therefore, until it's proven to me, I will not believe it." Jesus doesn't leave Thomas in that doubt, but rather returns once again to appear to Thomas. And what is his first word to Thomas? "Peace be with you." The completion of God's commissioning, not only of the other nine, but of Thomas as well. Or of the other ten, but Thomas as well. And in that moment, God's peace comes not only to the ten, but to Jesus as well. And I will tell you most assuredly that he speaks those same words in the midst of our lives today. Peace be with you. One of the parts in this lesson that I want us to pay special attention to is Jesus, after Thomas' confession that Jesus is Lord and God, says, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." That blessing from Jesus is for us. It's a blessing that transcends time and place, and one that is extended out to all of us sitting here today who may not have seen and yet have come to believe. And as a result of that, we've been commissioned to share in a part of the ministry of Jesus through his disciples. We've been called in a very short time to stand up, to leave this place, to go out into the world for Jesus' sake and with Jesus' word, knowing that we too have received that gift of the Holy Spirit that sends us out not in fear, but rather in faith, to witness to what it is that we have seen here. That Jesus Christ, who was dead, is now alive and working in the midst of our world. And the gift that's given to us is life. Life in his name. And I think that that is a gift that is well worth sharing. It has been said that we too live in a time of chaos, where many are afraid for many and various reasons. And Jesus steps today into the midst of our world and speaks those same words to us. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. In the midst of our everyday lives and in the midst of what may be going on for us individually, for our society, for our world. Boldly venturing forth with those words of Jesus, that if we forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if we retain the sins of any, they are retained. Going boldly in the world to proclaim what God has done. Because through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross, our sins have been forgiven us. And we're called to extend that forgiveness to others as well. But also knowing that just as surely as Jesus lived and as Thomas put his fingers in the nail marks in Jesus' hands and the hand in the wound in his decide
properly
that Christ is risen. And all glory and honor and praise go to God for that gift that we now have been called and commissioned to share with others. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The hymn of the day is, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Body of Christ given for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you with grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty Father, that you refresh us through the healing power of this gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy you would strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. Lord, look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
And thanks be to God.
The closing hymn.